And of course, we know that there's a, for any matrix, we know we're going to have to invert this thing. And for any matrix to be invertible, the condition has to be that J, which is the determinant of the J matrix, so this is a scalar value, in two dimensions, we have this condition. So this has to be true for J to be invertible, for that to work. So let's look at an example. So let's look at an example where we have three elements. So this is 1, 2, 3, 5 in the x direction. So this is element 1, and we have node number 1, 2, 3, 4, and then let's see, in the y direction we have 1, sorry, this is 0. And so in the y direction we're going to have 2, 3, 5. Okay, so these are not, the numbers on the outside are the actual coordinate locations of these sort of points, the nodes. Okay, the inside are the node numbers. So 1, 2, 3, 4, the local node numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. All right, so I've given, even though these two elements are roughly, they are the same shape, just a rotation of one another, I've given them alternate node numbers to see, let's see how that affects the ability to compute the Jacobian. So we have, by the way, element 2, element 3. So for element 1, we're going to have that J. I'll skip working through the details, but it's minus 1 half 1 plus eta 0, 2 minus 1 half C. All right, so therefore the determinant of J is equal to 1 half 4 minus xc, right? And because xc always goes from minus 1 to 1, then this is always going to be positive, right? So it's always invertible. Okay. For element 2, however, and we're going to have J is equal to 1 plus 1 half eta. So in this case, the determinant is this. And we can see that for xc equals to 1 plus eta, then this implies that the determinant of J, well, the scalar J, is equal to 0, and therefore this is not always invertible. For element 3, we have that J, the determinant of J is equal to minus 2 plus 1 half xc. And again, because xc always goes from minus 1 to 1, then this is always going to be true, and therefore it's always invertible.